what I say. Really? Wow. You know, there's a comedian in every crowd. The more people you get, the more comedians you have. I remember it this way growing up when I tried to be funny. My dad would say, you know, there's 1,000 comedians out of work, and here you are trying to be funny. All right. Well, we're continuing in our series on the Hall of Faith and looking at number 10 this morning, Hall of Faith Part 10. And we're going to be looking at Hebrews 11:22 and Genesis 48:20, but there's a whole lot of other scriptures we're going to be looking at today as well. So if you're able this morning, please stand for the reading and hearing of God's holy word today. Hebrews 11:21 says this: "By faith, Jacob, as he was dying, blessed each of the sons of Joseph and worshiped, leaning on the top of his staff." And Genesis 48:20. "He blessed them that day, saying, 'By you, Israel, will pronounce blessings, saying, May God make you like Ephraim and Manasseh.' Thus he put Ephraim before Manasseh." May God add his blessing in reading and hearing of his holy word. You may be seated today. Faith is foundational to being a Christian. If you're a Christian for any amount of time, you understand that trials and temptations come into our lives, and through those trials and temptations, God uses our faith to build us up. And through these trials and temptations, God will build our faith up. He will use these situations to grow us, to mature us. And it's easy to be saved and think that we're on top of the world. Amen. Anybody remember that feeling? Right after you get saved, man, you're just on top of the world. Nothing can touch you. But the longer you're a Christian, and the more Satan comes knocking at your door, the easier it is to feel at the bottom of the world. Amen? And that's why we have to have faith. And that's why we're going through this series on faith. To build us up. To look at these heroes in the Bible and to see that they were human. Just like us. They sinned. They had bad thoughts. They had doubts. But when the rubber met the road, every single one of these heroes of faith had one thing in common. What was that? What was one thing that all of these heroes had in faith? Come on, this is the 10th sermon on this. What's the one thing they all had in common? Faith. Yeah. Yeah. They had faith. They had faith. And we've been going through the corridors of this Hall of Faith and looking at the Jewish heritage, these folks who make up the Old Testament. Last week we looked at Abraham and Isaac, a father-son relationship. And this week we're going to look at Isaac and Jacob. Or 2 weeks ago, Abraham and Isaac, and then Isaac and Jacob. And now, the third week in a row, we're going to look at Jacob and his grandsons. And the cool part about these fathers that we've been encountering through the scripture is what I just said. They're humans, just like us. They experience the same thing. But at the end of the day, they trusted God. And so we're going to go through and tell the part of Genesis 48:20 that we just read, where Jacob blessed Joseph's two sons. But we can't fully grasp what is happening in this one scripture until we get some context, some understanding of some scriptures leading up to Genesis 48:20. We need to understand how it is that Jacob adopted his two grandsons in this blessing. Because just to say that isn't going to get us a full understanding of what's happening and in the context of Jewish history, Jewish tradition, and what's happening in the Bible. So we're going to look at quite a few scriptures. And again, we're not going to read all of them. I want you to take notes and this week read them and take a few minutes each day and do some Bible study with these scriptures that I'm going to give you. And it would do you well in building your faith in the coming weeks. And so our first point this morning is the promise continues. We've been looking several weeks now at a promise.
And that promise was made first to Abraham. It was made then to his wife Sarah. And that promise was made over 25 years to Abraham before it came to fruition about children. And that promise was that Abraham was going to have children as numbered as the stars in the sky and the sand of the sea. That he was going to have a nation come after him. Everybody remember what nation came after Abraham? What nation was it? Nobody remembers? It's a country today. It was founded again in 1948. Israel, yes. That is the nation that comes from Abraham. And so what we see is that God made a promise. And we've been looking at dozens and dozens of chapters in Genesis. And God, when he makes a promise, he'll keep it. May take a few years. We've seen that. But God will keep his promises. And so, in Genesis 48:2, it says this. Let me read that to you this morning. Write this down. When it was told to Jacob, "Behold, your son Joseph has come to you," Israel collected his strength and sat up on his bed. And it was told to Jacob, and then at the end of the scripture, he's called Israel. And so in this scripture, Genesis 48:2, I want you to notice today that Jacob is being called by two different names. Now, when we hear of Israel, what do we think of? A country, right? But he was renamed to Israel, Jacob was. You see, a few scriptures back, Jacob wrestled with the Lord. Genesis 38:28 says this, "And he said, Thy name shall be called no more Jacob, but Israel. For as a prince hast thou power with God and with men, and hast prevailed." So what happens here is Jacob is on this long journey, and God shows up in the flesh. And by the way, the theological term for this is called a theophany. And what that means is when God appears. Has God ever appeared to you in your life? Maybe not in the flesh like you and I, but God shows up in our weakest times, does he not? When you're weak and you're at the bottom of the barrel and you need some hope and you turn to God, he shows up, amen? God shows up. And so this is what happened to Jacob. Have any of you ever wrestled with God? Maybe not in the flesh, but maybe when God tells you to do something and you say, God, I just don't want to do it today. You're wrestling with God. And let me promise you something today, folks. You will lose. Every single person who's ever decided to go toe-to-toe with God Almighty is going to lose. Everyone has, and everyone hereafter will lose. And so did Jacob. But Jacob was a worthy opponent to God. You see, he stood up to God, he wrestled with God. And it says he has power. And so God renamed Jacob to Israel. You realize how many thousands of years ago that was? And there's still a country, a land named after Jacob. That poor little fellow right there probably thinks I keep talking about him. Maybe Jacob's probably like, why is he talking about me? This guy keeps saying my name. So what we see out of this renaming of Jacob as a great people, a great country, is named after this one man. And what we see is this promised seed of Abraham, of Isaac, and Jacob coming in the form of a country thousands of years later. Imagine how many millions of people have come from this one man named Abraham. And what we see is this promise continues. When God makes you a promise, he will always come through. Genesis 48:3-4 says this, "And then Jacob said to Joseph, God Almighty appeared to me at Luz in the land of Canaan and blessed me. And he said to me, Behold, I will make you fruitful and numerous, and I will make you a company of peoples, and will give this land to your descendants after you for an everlasting possession." This is that promised land that we've been talking about. God shows up. Remember, it's Abraham and his son Isaac and now Jacob. And God shows up and continues this same promise. Let me share something with you today. That same promise that God made them holds true to you and your kids and your grandkids and your great-grandkids. If you will truly be honoring to God, to worship Him, to be sold out for Jesus Christ, if you will give Him your everything, this promise holds true for you. God doesn't want you to show up with a half offering. God would rather you take that offering and go. He wants you to give Him your all.
Amen.
That's what Jesus talks about in the New Testament. He wants everything. He doesn't want our halfway. He says, you're either for me or against me. You're either warm, hot, or cold. He doesn't want us lukewarm. But how many of us show up with an offering of in the middle? Lukewarm. We show up and worship half-heartedly. We give 5% to God instead of what He commands of 10%. We say, you know what, God, I'll pray tomorrow. We say, you know what, God, I'll get in church when it's convenient. But this promise holds true to you. If you will give Him your all, He will give you His all. God will show up just like He did for Jacob. And He'll come through for you. And so the next thing we're going to look at this morning is what I call Cliff Notes history. In verse 5, we see this. Now your two sons who were born to you in the land of Egypt before I came to you in Egypt are mine. Ephraim and Manasseh shall be mine as Reuben and Simeon are. What we see here is this is Abraham, the story from Abraham to Isaac. And now we're dealing with Jacob and Joseph. So in the Hebrew scripture, we jumped 20 chapters in Genesis. The writer of the Hebrews just jumps stories. And so I'm going to give you a quick Cliff Notes history of what we missed in these 20 chapters of Genesis. Does that sound good to you guys? You want me to skip it? Trying to get you guys involved today. I'm trying to get you awake, involved. The last we saw, Jacob stole the birthright from Esau. Everybody remember that was here last week? Jacob stole the birthright from his brother. Jacob was the younger, and yet stole the birthright from his older brother. And so that was the last thing we saw. And remember, Esau became Edom. Then we had the Edomites who attack Israelites. And then we see Jacob fled. He fled from his country. He met a girl named Rachel. And he fell in love. Aw. Everybody say aw.
Aw.
It's a love story. Jacob fell in love. Oh, but you know how it is. It's like a sitcom right out of 2016. There's got to be drama, right? Right. So what's the drama with Jacob and Rachel? Here's the drama. So he shows up, he falls in love with this beautiful lady named Rachel, and he says, goes to his dad, and he says, Rachel's dad, can I have your daughter to marry? He goes, well, sure. But first you got to work for me for 7 years. Now, husbands, I don't want you to answer me out loud, but would you really be willing to work 7 years for your wives before you could have her hand in marriage? I'm not trying to get you in trouble, so don't answer me. So he says, okay, I love Rachel so much, I want to marry her. I'll work 7 years.
Good man.
Yes, good man. Way to go, Jacob. So he works 7 years, and at the end of it, he gets ready to marry Rachel. He's excited. And her dad goes, actually, you know what? I was just kind of kidding. You're going to marry your older sister.
Oh.
Oh. Yeah, oh. Now, doesn't this sound like a sitcom in 2016, right? And so Laban, Rachel's father, says, no, you're going to marry her older sister, Leah. So Jacob marries Leah. But Laban says, hey, you know what? You can actually have Rachel if you want, but you got to work another 7 years. So he's really in love with this Rachel girl, right? So he says, okay, I'll work another 7 years. While meantime, I'll be married to her older sister, Leah. So he works 7 years and he gets to marry Rachel. Now he has two wives who are sisters. Men, don't say a word. Don't say a word. I made the mistake of having this conversation with my wife on Friday. And I can assure you, this conversation did not go very well.
Well, I bet he's glad she didn't have any more sisters.
I bet you're right, yeah. If you didn't hear that, James said, I bet he was glad she didn't have any more sisters. You know, I never thought of that. I'm going to put that in my notes. I like that. Imagine if it was your family. There was, how many of you? Five?
We had seven sisters.
Seven sisters for that one. So,
actually, Pastor, he was threatened to marry Leah.
He was, yeah.
They know.
Yes. So here we go. Jacob flees. Okay? By Laban tricking him. By Laban tricking him. And Laban gives chase. And they meet up and come to an understanding. They meet up and come to an understanding. A man-to-man conversation, right? And so, they come to an understanding because of one thing. God was protecting Jacob. When tough times come, I want you to know that God wants to protect you. He may let some bad things happen to you. You might go through some pretty rough waters. But God's got your back. God has your back. It may not be easy, and I'm never going to promise it is. But God's got your back. And so this is where we come into this wrestling that we looked at a few minutes ago. Jacob wrestled with God at a place called Peniel. P-E-N-I-E-L. And thus receiving the name Israel, which literally means this. Israel is to wrestle with, and El is God. So Israel literally means to wrestle with God. And it's been that way for Israel ever since they became a nation. They have fought God, and God's whipped them, and they come back. And then they go against God and fight God, and then God whips them, and they come back. I think it's safe to say that every believer in God Almighty does that. Have any of you ever done that? You were doing great, you were walking with God, and then all of a sudden, something happens, and you start wrestling with God. You start rebelling. And you turn away. And God gets your attention, woman. He will whip your hiding. He will get your attention and bring you back. And this is what Israel's done for thousands of years. They wrestle with God. And so Jacob has 12 sons and one daughter by two wives and two handmaids. Now, this is really the conversation Shelley and I had Friday. It was all during this, you know, multiple wife thing, and I just want to throw a caveat out there. Just because it says this in the Bible does not mean it's okay to have a bunch of wives and handmaids that you can have at your disposal. Just because they did this, I don't believe God is okay with that. And so, when you read these things, realize that God may not have been very happy with Jacob for what he was doing. You see, God has always created us with one man and one woman, right? It was Adam and Eve. It wasn't Adam and Steve. It wasn't Adam and Eve and her sister Becky. It was always supposed to be from the beginning. One man and one woman. In fact, Jesus says that in the New Testament. So just because you read this does not mean God's okay with it. But it happened, it's history, and so we report it. So we find out in these chapters that Joseph is Jacob's favorite. And he's given a coat of many colors. Anybody ever heard the Dolly Parton song, Coat of Many Colors? Isn't that cool? I like that. I'm not going to sing it for you, don't worry. But we talked again last week about this favoritism thing, and it's not cool. We shouldn't have favorites as kids or grandkids. God doesn't like that. We saw in these 20 chapters, Joseph is sold into slavery because his brothers were angry and they were jealous with him. And so he was sold into slavery. And Joseph, during this 20 chapters, eventually becomes the number two man in all of Egypt under Pharaoh. He worked his way up from being sold into slavery to being the number two man in Egypt. Why? Because God favored him. See, sometimes when we're faithful and we just wait, we do our part, and we show our faith, God blesses us with things we've been asking for. And that's what happened here with Joseph. He did his part, he waited and was faithful, and God blessed him to be number two man. So then we see in these 20 chapters a famine in the land, and because God had shown Joseph what to do, the Egyptians, their storehouses were bountiful. They had food for this famine that showed up. The Jews end up in Egypt, and Joseph was reunited with his son that he thought was dead. Jacob was reunited with his son, Joseph, that he thought was dead all those years. And so I just summarized Genesis 28 to 48. I encourage you guys this week to go read these. Man, this is cool stuff. You read, you watch movies, right? You watch TV sitcoms. This is cooler than all of that. And this is real life, man. This is real stuff. So go read that this week and see what else God can show you. And so this leads us up to where we are in our scripture. The point about adoption, and it's Genesis 48, 5 through 6, and it says this: Now your two sons who were born to you in the land of Egypt, this is Jacob speaking to his son Joseph, okay? Before I came to you in Egypt are mine. Ephraim and Manasseh shall be mine, as Reuben and Simeon are. But your offspring that have been born after them shall be yours, and they shall be called by the names of their brothers in their inheritance. This is where Jacob is literally saying that he's taking two of his grandsons, two of Joseph's sons, and he's adopting them as if they were his own for birthright, for inheritance purposes. And we looked at that last week. The oldest gets the most, and then so on down the line. And so he's saying, my two grandsons, I'm adopting as if they are my own children. Not only is he taking them for inheritance purposes, but making them first and second son of his own. Now think about that. You're the oldest. Think about this. Put yourself in these shoes. You're the oldest child. Your father's getting ready to die, and you've got all these, in today's economy, millions and millions of dollars waiting on you when your father dies. You're the oldest or the second oldest, and you're getting the biggest chunk. And all of a sudden, one day, your dad goes, hey, you just got bumped down to third and fourth place. Not only did you get bumped down, but my grandchildren are taking your place. Wow. How many of us would be Christ-like in that situation? What do you mean? I've been faithful all these years, Dad. I've done everything you've told me to do, and now I just get booted down the line because of my nephews. I think many of us would be pretty upset. And that's what's happening here. They've been replaced in the inheritance line. And remember how important this birthright is in the Jewish tradition. Being firstborn son meant that you had a double portion of inheritance. You had double what all your brothers got. And what he's saying here is, he's saying, Joseph, you were betrayed by your brothers. You were sold into slavery. They told me you were dead. I'm giving you that birthright by adopting your sons. I'm giving you that oldest birthright. I'm repaying you for the bad that happened in your life. Now, Joseph had to wait a long time. But when God repaid him for the faithfulness, and I want you to miss this, when God repaid him for his faithfulness, he got a double portion. His two sons were adopted. Now remember, we talked about Joseph being sold into slavery. Joseph, all the bad that had happened to him, he waited on God to show up. And when he did, God repaid him for his faithfulness. How many of us have the faith to do that? How many of us have the faith to keep going? Serving God no matter what. Not turning on what we know is right. But just staying faithful to the one true God. And this adoption becomes significant in these two grandsons, because now they have the namesake of Israel. And they will have a portion of the promised land. For us, what is the promised land? Remember, we learned that. Heaven. You too can have a portion of the promised land. But to have that portion of the promised land, you've got to have Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior. You can't go to heaven without having the blood of Christ covering your sins. So that leads us to the blessing that we were talking about. Genesis 48, 13 through 20. And this is the actual blessing that Jacob is giving. And I'm not going to read it all. And this idea of the right hand versus the left hand is significant because the prominent position is on the right hand. Where does Jesus Christ sit? On the right hand of the throne of God. And so Jacob tells his grandsons, come to my right. This is a position of prominence, a position of power. Colossians 3:1 says this, if you're risen with Christ, seek those things which are above, where Christ sits on the right hand of God. And so he tells his grandson to sit on my right. You see, we have that opportunity to sit on the right hand of God as well, because Jesus Christ died for us. We have the power and the prominence to take this world by storm. We don't have to be scared anymore. We don't have to live in fear. We don't have to keep our mouths shut. Because we have power. We have prominence. We have position. And once you grab a hold of that, and you stop living in fear, and you stop living cowering in the corner, and you stop doing what is politically correct, and you stand up and say, thus saith the Lord God, I am a child of the one true King. I sit at the right hand throne of God where my Savior Jesus Christ sits. He is mine, and I have power. I have prominence. I have position. We will stop living as defeated people and start living as if we have hope. But you got to grab a hold of that. Got to grab a hold of that and understand it. That's a blessing we have. Genesis 48, 15 through 16 shows Jacob's blessing is really in form according to the Hebrew law of poetic parallelism. Properly, he has said he blessed Joseph while he was blessing his sons. You see, he blessed Joseph while blessing his sons. We've been adopted into the family. When Jesus was blessed and when he was raised from the dead and we accept Christ, we are being blessed. Do you get that? We are being blessed just like these two. Part one of this blessing shows God the Father. Part two of this blessing shows provision from God to the Father. From God the Father. And then part three of this blessing shows protection from God the Father. This is the same blessing God gives us. When we accept Christ as our Lord and Savior, he shows that he is our Father now. We've been adopted. It shows that he is providing for us. And then it shows that he is our protector. This is the blessing that God gives you. This is the blessing that God gives me. That God is our Father. That God is our provider. That God is our protector. We lose sight of that sometimes, don't we? We forget that it's God who takes care of these things. But it is Him. And that leads us to our last point this morning. The faith. Hebrews 11:21. By faith, Jacob, when he was dying, blessed both the sons of Joseph and worshipped, leaning on the top of his staff. Imagine this. He's dying. He can barely walk. He can barely stand. But Jacob stands up. And he believes that God will take Joseph's two sons and give them the same blessing of inheritance as his own sons. As his own sons. And he worshiped leaning upon his staff. This is a direct quote of Genesis 47:31, which says this. And he said, "Swear to me," so he swore to him. And Israel bowed and worshipped at the head of the bed. This is literally showing on his deathbed yet again that he worshipped. You know, I've heard stories of dear saints who have passed and they're on their deathbed and they're worshiping. They're not scared. They're not worried that there might not be an afterlife. They know without a shadow of a doubt that what God has promised is true. And they worship in their dying breaths. How many of us have the faith that if we were on our deathbed right now, we'd worship? We'd worship and say, "God, I believe. I've got the promised land. As soon as I take my last breath here, I'm going to take my first breath in the promised land called heaven." He had faith to believe that the blessing from God would go down to all of the sons. Jacob's faith was that he believed God's promise that he had heard all of his life, and that his seed would be a great nation. And there would be peoples and countries and lands from his children. He believed in the blessing of his adopted sons and giving them a spot one and spot two, that God would come true on his promise. Do you believe in God for something today? Is there something you've been struggling with that you're waiting on God to answer? Maybe it seems like years you've been waiting on God. Maybe it seems like decades you've been waiting on God. Maybe it's just been weeks or months. Do you have faith to keep waiting on God? Whether it's medical, whether it's financial, whether it's relationships, whether it's professional, do you have faith to take God at His word and to trust, no matter what the circumstance tells you, no matter what the people around you tell you, no matter what the trial says, temptation coming your way, do you truly have the faith to wait till your dying breath for God to answer? That's the faith that Jacob exhibited in his life, waiting till his dying breath for God to answer. You see, many of us, if we don't get our answer right away, we get angry at God. We curse God. We turn our back on God. And say, well, God didn't take care of me, so why should I keep being faithful? You see, that's all part of the test. Do you have the faith to trust, even if it takes till your dying breath, for God to answer you? Let us pray together. Father, our God, our Dad in heaven, I pray that we all have the faith to wait. Wait on you what we're waiting for, even if it takes to our dying breath. God, I pray that today, if there's anybody that doesn't know Jesus Christ as their personal Lord and Savior, that God, today they would be saved. That they would turn from their wicked ways and see that they need Jesus. Father, if there's any backslidden believers here today, God, that they've been wavering and they've turned and they're wrestling with you now, that God, they'll stop wrestling. They'll get on their knees here today. Say, God, I give it to you. Turn my life back over to you for you to have control and I can be sold out. God, if there's anybody that just needs special prayer today, I pray they'll have the faith to come forward and get on their knees and trust you to pray today. In the powerful name of Jesus Christ, our Lord. And everybody said, amen. If you're not saved today, you've never accepted Christ as your personal Lord and Savior. You've never turned from your sins. Well, I want you to know that that promised land can be yours. All you got to do is ask Jesus to save you. Help you turn from your wicked ways. Maybe you are a Christian and you've just been living backslidden. You haven't been living for Christ. You're not sold out. Giving Him your all. If that's you today, He wants you to give Him your all. He wants you to get on your knees and say, God, I'm 100% yours. I want to be sold out. If you just need special prayer today, the altar's open. If you need me, grab me and we'll pray together. Or if you just want to pray by yourself, the altar's open.